Okay, so thanks, Benji, for this really great talk, which actually affects us a bit. I will come to that later. So I will give you a presentation about what we did during the last year on our course towards making Gnode an operating system that we can use in our day-to-day computing activities. First, the spoiler, we are not there yet, so there are still some kind of way to go. But on the other hand, I'm pretty proud of the things that we have achieved. So I don't know if everyone is familiar with the project, I guess not. So I will first give you a brief introduction into Gnode, what it is and where it comes from. Then the main part of the talk will be about the challenges that we faced during the last year and how we overcame them. And finally, I want to give some rough idea of what are the pieces that are left or that we feel should be in place before we can really do the switch to Gnode. Finally, I will give you a few other points that I find interesting during last year and give a short overlook of the planning for the next year. So first, why are we have we started the whole project? So it originates in something like 2006. And back then I was at the University of Dresden, and we always got confronted with these kind of universal truths that seem to be ultimately true. So for example, people always say that security is contradictory to ease of use. So security is always in the way. You have to remember passwords, or you have to configure security. So like SE Linux has this kind of notion that it's hard to configure, so nobody is really using it. So that seems to be like a common wisdom. The same kind of conflict we see when it comes to the use of resources. So most operating systems today, such as Linux, are optimized to make the best out of the hardware resources. Use all the amount of resources like memory to the maximum extent possible. On the other hand, there's some kind of desire to make processes accountable for their resource usage. So for example, it's not really good that any program that has access to the X server can deny the service of the X server by just having an infinite loop of creating windows. The problem is that the X server is paying for the resources, not the client. And the same is for network-heavy applications that are running in the user land. They produce a demand for resources in the kernel, and so those resources are not properly accounted for. So there seems to be a kind of need for a sweet spot between both kind of goals. And finally, complexity seems to be contradictory to scalability. So in dependable systems or high security systems, people want to have low complexity, because low complexity means low probability for bugs. So these guys like things like isolation kernels, really small static pieces of kernels. On the other hand, there's demand for security in a wide field of applications, but where you cannot use such rigid kernels. And for this reason, people put Unix in the telephone, so because they need scalability. So has no one really figured out how to be low complex yet still scalable. And we thought that we kind of have the technologies available to solve these kind of conflicts. And of course, there are microkernels. I don't have to explain this here in this room. And there's also well-developed knowledge about how to split big software into smaller pieces, into critical parts, non-critical parts, interfacing them. Also, we know about capability-based security since many years, and we know that it's vastly superior to most of the security concepts we have today in our systems. And also, we have virtualization since many years, which could bridge the gap from the current situation to a new modern system. So the technologies are obviously here, and they are not new. They are decades old. The question is, why hasn't someone came up and used those technologies to build something new. And I think when I thought a lot about it, and I think these are kind of the ingredients. Like if you have the notion of a painter, a guy who is an artist who paints a picture, he uses colors, obviously, and those colors had been invented beforehand. But it takes an artist or a kind of to compose those colors, give them a shape in order to produce something useful or something beautiful. And so the technologies alone are not sufficient. You have to bring them together in a unique way to compose them. And I think, or at least some years back, I had an idea for such a composition. And this composition looks like this. So the system is structured as a tree. So we know a tree, okay, that's in Unix also has a tree of processes. But this tree is different. Here, each relationship between the parent and the child is an ownership relationship. So the parent always owns the child. And this has two implications. Ownership means that you have ultimate control over what you own. So if a process owns another process, it can decide what a child process gets to see, how it operates, it can destroy the process, and so on. It has full control, it has full ownership. On the other hand, what ownership also means is responsibility. So the parent is responsible for the child. So it has to provide resources to the child. It has to hold the child accountable for the resource spent, for the resources spent. And so this is kind of the broad picture, and the implication of this kind of architecture is that we can tailor the trusted computing base for each component of the system individually. So whereas on monolithic systems like Linux, we have a huge trusted computing base in the kernel and in the, all the processes that are running as root user. In Gnode, you can have for each component in the system the kind of chain of dependencies from which this process depends. And in this case, of course, that's the chain of parents, and also, let's say, a service that is used by the process. But the interesting part is that other unrelated parts of the system are not included in the trusted computing base of this guy. And so we can radically reduce the trusted computing base for a lot of applications. And of course, this can be combined with virtualization. So we can just put virtual machines as a leaf nodes of the tree, and this opens up a way to move from today to tomorrow. So this is the idea and the vision that we had some years back, but how to get there. So we decided to follow the approach to found a company to do that, just that. So we left the university and founded the company Gnode Labs. It's a self-funded company, so no venture capital, it's fully independent. And we cross-funded the development through consulting activities, actually. And so the idea was to just start, let's look how it works and go from there. So not much of a kind of growth plan or something like that. Today we are 8 people, and so pretty small still, the company. And we have trusted relationships with a quite diverse customer base, which is really, we should really enjoy. And yeah, we are still mainly doing contracting work, so there's not much licensing that we get from Gnode yet. So what do we have? So as a company, as a product, so basically what we try to advertise is that we have a kind of set of Lego bricks that we can stick together to build interesting things out of. And we understand this in a way that even the kernel is such a piece, such a component. So Gnode does not use a specific kernel, but it gives the user of the framework a choice to pick one of those kernels. So don't worry about the size font, it's just an illustration. So we support a variety of different kernels, and each kernel has different characteristics, pros and cons. And on top of those kernels, you need to do something with the hardware, for example. So there are a bunch of device drivers. So further Lego bricks that you can put together, and now you have access to PCI or to some specific frame buffer driver and so on. So we take care about enabling drivers on platforms. And furthermore, there are runtime environments where you can actually execute useful things. For example, there is for Linux for the Fiasco OOC kernel, so developed by the guys back there. Or there are a virtual machine monitor for the Nova micro hypervisor. And so these are runtime environments that enable you to execute something useful. But the whole thing that gives the whole system some kind of scalability is that low-level resources, hardware resources, can be multiplexed to virtual resources. This is done by these guys. And then there's a whole bunch of protocol stacks that we can use to translate resources to different resources. For example, the resource block device to the resource file system. So this is basically a translation of an abstraction level. And those components are basically such protocol stacks. And using this infrastructure, it becomes possible to host quite a diverse a range of applications on top of the system. So for example, this is a kind of a runtime environment that enables us to run unmodified GNU software on top of GNU. So this is a kind of this kind of Lego set you see here. And now, of course, we are eager to try out whether we can use those bricks to build something that we could actually use in practice for day-to-day computing. So so this was our goal. Actually, 2 years ago, we set this goal. And we are not yet here because the way is actually longer than we thought. So I will go first into some fundamentals that we had to get right beforehand. So we decided to focus on the Nova kernel here because we are using x86 and we want to use virtualization and all the capabilities like IO MMU support. So we had to spend some time to get IO a concept for supporting IO MMUs implemented in Gnode. We had to fix some things in the kernel. For example, the Nova kernel did not have any implementation of regaining kernel memory once it's used. So you could create a kernel object like a thread, but once you kill a thread, you won't regain the kernel resources. So at some point, the kernel would just run out of memory. So we had to implement those things, like the proper revocation of those resources. Also, we had to find a concept of multiprocessor support, which was quite challenging on Nova, because this particular kernel has a kind of limitation. The limitation is that it provides a synchronous IPC, so to send messages across processes, which is the only means to delegate resources in the system, like memory pages or communication rights. So you always have to do IPC to delegate those resources. But the limitation is that you can do IPC only along one CPU. You cannot have cross-CPU IPC on Nova. So that's quite heavy limitation. So we tried to convince Udo Steinberg, who is the author of Nova, to implement global or cross-processor IPC for us, but he would not do that because that would mean to take a lock in the IPC path. So we had to come up with another solution. And we found one and implemented this, which is quite simple. It has only a few modifications in the kernel, keeps the lock-free IPC path, and just employs a little trick. So once we discover that we do a cross-processor IPC, we create a new thread out of thin air, basically on the stack in the kernel, that plays the role of a proxy for doing the IPC. It inherits the UTCV from the calling process, but it lives on its target CPU, and then performs the local IPC. So it's pretty simple. That way, everything became pretty simple. It's quite cool, I think. The next thing is we had to come up with a scheme how to manage those processor resources, so how to manage CPU affinities. And here we found a nice solution that is in line with this Gnode concept where we have this recursive architecture of these components. And so we decided that we can assign the physical CPU to basically the root of the process tree. So the root of the process tree sees everything. And this affinity space, how we call it, is basically what this kind of guy can use. And now if this process spawns another process, it can virtualize this affinity space and present to this child process only this portion of the affinity space, so that this guy would think that there are only these kind of physical CPUs in the system. So we could successively subdivide the resources along the process tree. So the other fundamentals apart from the kernel are device drivers. But here the positive thing is that the most fundamental things are already in place. So we had not invest much time during the last year to do it. Next big topic is of course file systems. And one part of the puzzle is that Gnode doesn't use any virtual file system. There is basically one virtual file system per process. So that's basically part of the C library. And this gives us a lot of freedom. So we are still in the process of improving it, but the general concept seems to work very well. But when it comes to real FileSystem implementations, of course we did not want to implement FileSystems from scratch. Like, unlike you guys, we tried to reuse lots of software. And so we figured once we have Fuse on Gnode, we would have solved this problem. So we ported Fuse to Fuse-based FileSystems to Gnode, and this worked actually. But we figured out that the FileSystems we are most interested in, such as X-FileSystem, they are not really well supported in Fuse because those are already supported in the Linux kernel. And typically, people use Fuse for FileSystems that are not in the Linux kernel. So you don't have any really stable version of an X-FileSystem on Fuse, for example. But at the same time, when we discovered that, we discovered the work of Antti Kanti and started working on bringing RUMP to Gnode. And this was really a great experience. So we got it working in less than a month. And it's actually enables us right now to use all those nice file systems from NetBSD on Gnode. So, and of course, we will make this part of the next Gnode release scheduled for February. So that was really easy. I can confirm the claim in the last talk. And it works really cool. So for TCP/IP, we traditionally relied on lightweight IP, which was actually working quite well. But once we went beyond fast Ethernet, we discovered that there are some features missing in lightweight IP which won't be implemented anytime soon. Like TCP window scaling is just missing, and so for gigabit Ethernet, it's really we just got poor performance out of it. So we decided to go to the approach to just port the TCP/IP stack from Linux to Gnode. And the interesting point here is that we somehow managed to bring all the kernel threads of Linux into one single flow of control. So this is basically the whole Linux TCP/IP stack is just a library with no threads. It's just one, a single threaded thing. And it works and it brings a good performance. So that's quite funny, this experience. So, yeah, and now we can actually use this TCP/IP stack to get quite decent performance for gigabit networking as well. So now we have file systems, the kernel is somehow fixed to a certain degree. We want to use the system, okay, we need functionality. It all starts that we need to have a simple user interface, like a simple command line interface to deal with the system. And so we came up with a very small program which you see here on the left. So this allows us for example, start an application. So we can start a program here. And we can look into the memory usage of the application over here. And yeah, we can kill it again. So these are really the most fundamental functions. We also need figured that we need a kind of stopgap solution for getting productive with working on Gnode, and virtualization is obviously the right way to do that. This was actually one point why, for which reason we picked Nova as our primary platform, because it has these kind of very attractive virtual machine monitor. Which is actually maintained by you, which is really, really nice. So I can give you a quick impression. So we can start, for example, TinyCool Linux here using the Vancouver, or nowadays it's called Seoul VMM. And the nice thing is that it's quite fast. So the guys who did measurements achieved almost native performance, apart from the graphics maybe. And it actually, you see it. It actually works quite well, and it's quite fast, and we can actually use Firefox and things like that. And you have just two mouse cursors, that's not really convenient, but these are things that we can, of course, fix. But you can see there is some way to reuse existing Linux. Downside is that this solution is quite hard to use. So it took us, for example, 3 days to bring this Linux version up in this install. You need a lot of tweaking of the Linux OS to make it happy in this kind of environment. So that's not a kind of out-of-the-box working thing. And for example, there is no real BIOS in part of the virtual machine, so the normal VESA driver of Xorg will not work. Things like that. Yeah, we don't need use Xorg here for this. It's a different one. So this was the reason why we investigated in bringing a kind of established virtualization solution to Gnode as well, and we kind of wondered, is it possible to bring VirtualBox to Gnode? And to basically, we wanted to profit from the whole rich feature set and all the device models that are in there that allows you to have this kind of out-of-the-box working experience, but to combine this with the strong security model that Nova provides with its own virtualization interface, so that each virtual machine lives in a user space, address space, which is protected for against the other parts of the system. And this actually turned out to work. So I can start another VM here, which is, for example, Windows. And so the most challenging part here was to find the right way to cut the pieces of VirtualBox away that are tied to Linux or to the traditional host environments and replace them with Nova interfaces. So at the beginning, it takes a while. We still have not figured out why there is a kind of dead time at the beginning. So basically, normally VirtualBox is calling into the kernel to issue a build switch to the guest OS, and the kernel will take care of doing the VM enter, VM exit, and the whole build switch thing. And so this is done using a kind of virtual device, that's the VBox driver device, and we just thought, okay, let us replace this kind of device interface, this I/O control interface, with something that we provide on user level on Nova. Let me see if this is still doing something. Oh no, it's not doing something. I see there are some. I will give it another try. So I just integrated this some on Thursday, so it's still something that is in progress. So let me just give it another try. Oh no. Again, like last year. So, okay. Would you give me another chance? I will just reboot to get in a clean state. So there are still some issues that we have to overcome. Like, for example, the deallocation of virtual CPUs in Nova and things like that. So please stay with me. Okay. So I'll just jump to the slides. Okay. So let's give it another try. So this whole activity required us to really get a deep understanding on how VirtualBox works. So this is a massive piece of software. It's hundreds of thousands lines of code, and to identify the parts that are actually critical for this kind of device models that we want to use, and the parts that could be omitted or could be replaced with Nova specific interfaces. So I hope this time it will work better. Let's see. Ah, there's something happening on screen. So that's one thing. Once we got this kind of VM state switching right, we could actually see that a lot of these kind of guest operating systems were working, and this is was exactly what we hoped for. So that we can use all this work that had invested in, so that you can actually use it somehow. I think. I'm not proficient. I think I have to click on the start button to do something. It's still installing some device drivers and things like that, but you can see it's actually somehow usable. I know Windows is trying to change screen resolution, improving screen resolution. I think it will try this for a second time as well. Yeah. We just pretend there's only one VESA mode, so Windows will just stick to it. And yeah, you can see that's actually working. And so, and actually a lot of people asked us for such a feature, running Windows on GNOME. And yeah, of course, during our work to get this running, we experimented a lot with other systems. For example, this guy is working also, of course. And it's for all of us quite funny, so we also tried Knuhurt and all kinds of images that we could find, and each has prompted different issues to us, and so we had to fix them. So now if you want to have a kind of round of papers, we can actually do this as well, like, yeah, using kind of. So. So next thing to get productive is a way for us to execute existing GNU software on GNOME. Of course, we need to have a GCC and things like that available. And our solution for that is this so-called GNU runtime. And this is basically a very lightweight runtime environment that allows us to work with these classical Unix software. So for example, we can start a dedicated runtime environment for just configuring the system. And so this subsystem is called config over here. So that is a new environment, which is completely in a virtual environment. It does not have any global view on the system, but it has some file system mounted, which contains configuration files for the system. So for example, for this Niptiger graphics server over here, there's a configuration file we can access over here. And so this is basically the configuration of Niptiger. And if you want to change the configuration, for example, adding a specific core for this window over here, I have to just tell this policy. For example, this program is called NIT-SD CLI. And we have to change the color to something bright, maybe, something like this. And once I save the file, you will see that this change will be applied. So that's the kind of approach that we take. We have classical Unix software like Vim and CoreUtils, Fine, and so on, and use it to our advantage here, and have the comfort that we enjoy today with Linux, we want to have on GNOME as well, and Nux is our way to get there. So let's close again. And you see, it's really quick. You can start it up. In contrast to the virtual machines, it's really snappy, and it's like spawning a shell, and you have a virtual new environment. We also enabled the GNU debugger on top of GNOME in user space. And for rich applications like a web browser, we are relying on Qt. So we made a change from Qt4 to Qt5. And can use a WebKit-based browser on this way. And this also runs natively on GNOME. And yeah, it posed some really challenges, but we figured them out. another part is, of our concerns was to make the system usable is we have to get a decent performance out of the system. And so we need to have a way to look into the system. You have seen this Lego bricks. So there are a bunch of components. They are all somehow living together in the system. And if there's some performance bottleneck somewhere, we have to figure this out somehow. So we need a tool for that. And one way to get there is to have a kind of tracing toolkit, similar to dtrace. So we wanted to have something similar on GNOME as well. The important part is we don't want to spend resources on the tracing itself. That would just change the behavior of the system and would spoil the information that we get out of it. We also want to not to rely on one particular kernel. So building a solution into a specific kernel, such as Nova, would be useless if we used another kernel. So GNOME is all about this kind of inter-kernel operability, so we needed to maintain this kind of goal. Also, to our concern, we also wanted to make the resources needed for something like trace buffers properly accounted to the users of the trace framework. So there is no magic allocation happening somewhere. And another concern is that we needed a kind of level of abstraction that allows us to reason about what's going on. So for example, if you use the Fiasco kernel debugger for tracing, so there's a nice tracing buffer over there, you will see all these kind of messages like thread ID this sends a message to thread ID that, but you don't know what's the payload of the message, for example. And it's really hard if you have this kind of complexity in the system to figure out what's going on. So we need a higher level of abstraction. And what we also want is we want to enable it all the time and want to change the policy at runtime. So once at runtime we are interested in the behavior of a particular thread, we want to enable the tracing for this thread and look into it. And then disable it again, so it should be always present and always usable, similar to how dtrace is working. But in contrast to dtrace, we want not to have the complexity of the implementation. We want it to be really usable. The architecture, really a brief outline, looks as follows. To get a good performance or low overhead, there is one trace buffer per set. And so this trace buffer is paid for by the guy who traces the thread. So this is the trace monitor, this is the site who traces the thread. The guy who sits between both is the core process of Gnode. This is the root of the process tree. So there's a kind of service which allows the tracing monitor to interface with the tracing facilities. And the traced processes, in turn, they obtain the tracing information from the normal CPU interface of the core. So, for example, each time the trace process hits the trace point, it just looks in some bits in the shared memory region about changes of the tracing policy. And once the process starts being traced, it will detect that and will then pull the policy for the tracing and the trace buffer from core. So there is no pushing of tracing things in the other space, no patching of the binary or something like that. The process itself is getting the tracing buffers and also the tracing policy from core in this way. So I will give you a short demo. So we can, one thing, there's this trace monitor, and this could be a custom program. For the most parts, we program these problem specific, but there's one trace monitor which is just, which arrived just this week, which is a file, comes in the form of a file system. So we can start the so-called TraceFS. And we mount this file system in a dedicated Nuke session again. So if you look here, we have some typical directories here, but there's one particular one which is the trace directory, and this is a file system that actually is a bit like a proc file system but for tracing processes. So when you look in here, we see the process hierarchy of Gnode. So first we see the init process. So if you go in there, you see the children of the init process. You see here the networking driver, SAPA driver, and all these kind of processes that are running on the system. And so we also see that there is this kind of CLI monitor, this program, is also in there. So let's go in there. So if you look in there, we see, this CLI monitor again says a child process called TraceFS, which is the scenario that I just started. And short notice, the entries with the numbers attached, these are actually real threads in the system. And the directory entries that without numbers are processes. Just as a kind of, So we go into the TraceFS subsystem, and in there we see, there's a liquid frame buffer. This is basically the thing that draws the window borders over here. Then there's a terminal, then there's a Nuke session. So, and there's also a RAMFS. So this is the actual file system server over here. So you see this kind of, the whole thing, the idea of composing systems out of these kind of small components is really in place here. So we can go into the Nuke's runtime over here. And what we see here is, we have a bash that is executed in here, and some helper processes. And let's have a look into this kind of Nuke's process over here, which is basically the kernel thread of Nuke's, of the bash in this case. So if you go into this directory, we find these kind of pseudo files, and here we can control the tracing for this process. So, for example, I can just issue a one into the enable file, And now if I look into the active file, we will see zero. Ah, okay, so we have enabled it, but it's not active. So the reason is we have not yet loaded a policy. So we have first loaded policy, which we do by packing a file containing the binary policy into the policy. And now if we do the same again, you see, now it's also active. You can also observe that if you just look at the file size, and we see here the events are actually increasing, so there are some events coming in. And so now we can just do a cat of the events, and we see what's going on. So you see this, basically the RPC calls that are issued by this thread. And there are pairs of those calls, because there's always a trace point when calling, when doing an RPC call, and also a trace point when we receive an RPC. And the cool thing here is that the policy of what is locked is all contained in this kind of small policy module that I loaded. And this cannot be replaced at runtime. So we can basically recompile this policy and stick it to a thread, remove it from a thread, and so on. So let's disable this again. Okay. So next topic was the way of getting resource management fit for general purpose computing. So in Gnode we have the concept that that parents assign their own resources to their children, which is the general rule in the system. So there's everyone a kind of conscious decision to use resources. But at some points you cannot know in advance how much resources a child needs. So for example, if this is a windowing system over here, the resources needed for the windowing system depend on the number of windows that are present on screen, for example. So it's not known in advance, it will change over time. And so there is no clear knowledge of how should I dimension this kind of resources. I could just over-provision resources, which would be a kind of waste. And for this reason, Gnode has the way to for processes to trade resources among the system. So for example, the graphics server has not much resources when we started, but once a client connects to the graphics server, like here, the client can actually lend out some of its own resources to the server. So this is basically a transfer of resources to the server, and then the server will work with those resources. And for a properly server, a written server, the server will keep track on the different amounts of resources dominated by the various clients, and use those resources for those for bringing servers for the clients. And this solves this kind of initial problem. But still, there was some open issue. The open issue is that there are some things in operating systems, in particular caches, that have no clients. They are something like a block cache. It can utilize memory, but there's no way to say, okay, I want to use this amount of the block cache. Also, it just should use all slack memory that is there. So we wanted to have a way to somehow have processes who can allocate resources as much as they want, as much resources as there are, but that are also able to give back those resources to the system when they are needed otherwise. So something like a cache, where you could say, please flush the cache, we want to use the memory for something else. On Linux or monolithic systems, this is all in the kernel. So the kernel has all the knowledge about the user level problems, the abstractions like files and so on, and can implement a block hash in an efficient way. On a microkernel system, that's not the case. So we have to find some way to implement this functionality in a different way. So we decided to refine the parent interface, so the interface between client between the parent process and the child process, to support this kind of protocol, to tell a child process, please, it would be nice of you if you could yield some resources to me. Or and on the other way, a child process can also say to the parent, hey, I run out of resources, it would be nice of you if you could give me more resources. So you have more like a dynamic balancing of resources in the system. And for, as a proof of concept, we implemented a ballooning driver for L for Linux, just to see if this works, and this is working quite well. The last point here is stability, of course. We have seen this is actually still an issue. So we are also pretty big fans of automated tests and invested a lot of time in those. So you, here you see a diagram that we look at each day. This basically is a report of the tests that we run. So you can see over time the number of tests we have increases, and so the different colors say which tests fail. For example, here we had a real bad commit in our staging branch, so the build bot or test bot really failed to execute many tests. And then we fix it again, and we see, ah, okay, now it's, everything is nice. And once we click on some point over here, we see this table. And so you see here there are a bunch of different kernels that we test, different platforms, also on real hardware, not just on QEMU. Then we have a bunch of test cases that we throw on those different platforms. And we see, ah, most are okay, and when there's an error occurring, we can click on the error, see all the log output, and can investigate. And it's, without these kind of tools, it's impossible to do to develop GNode. It's really fundamentally important to also to uphold the quality. And this kind of automation goes beyond just building and testing. It's also benchmarking. So for example, here we see a diagram of the performance of this kind of toolchain benchmark. So when we execute the GNode toolchain on GNode using nukes on different kernels, so here's the time it takes to compile GNode on GNode. Using different kernels. And here you see some things.